concerning traffic safety on Mitchell Road, and attached to that was also a report from Bob Hunter dated August 15th regarding Mitchell Road. Just on Broad Cove Highlands project, Stephen F. Wright, 66 Hunts Point Road, is concerned about the traffic safety, open space wetlands, destruction of trees, and is opposed to a full access and would like to see an emergency access only. Eleanor Redmond of 1235 Sawyer Road, November 16th, opposed to a full connector road between Broad Cove. She feels that the negative impacts on both neighborhoods would constitute a deterioration of the quality of the areas. George Marchant, or Marchant, I think it is, 4 Hunts Point Road, supports the recent petition concerning the wetlands and feels that developments should have impact fees. October 10th, residents of Two Lights Road concerned about an increase in traffic, drainage, pollution of streams, loss of open space, wildlife, and this was signed by numerous residents of Two Lights, 33 citizens in all, of all ages, I might add. Page 2, October 26th, a letter to Mike McGovern from Rachel Perry of 10 Pine Ridge Road, clarifying the petition and requesting that the town attorney's opinion be released to citizens prior to the town council meeting, which was held on November 13th. October 27th, Thomas Rutledge of 47 Hunts Point Road is concerned about the current plan. He preferred the previous plan, and he cites a lack of cooperation of the planning board and says that we are not cooperating with the applicant. However, I would just like to say, in a very short response, that the planning board cannot plan subdivisions, and we are doing our very best to cooperate with this applicant and did have a workshop meeting several weeks ago. Harold Fletcher, October 27th, of 38 Hunts Point Road, is concerned about the current plan, namely the access road. He supports emergency access only. Peter and Patricia Barris, October 30th, 74 Hunts Point Road, they are concerned about increased development, wetlands, and oppose a full access. October 31st, Deborah J. Johnston of 71 Hunts Point Road is the mother of 3 children. She is opposed to a full access road because of traffic safety in the area. Mary Alice Riley of Two Lights Road has a concern for wildlife and wants larger lot sizes with open fields for people and wildlife to enjoy. She too feels there is much too much traffic on Two Lights Road and opposes a connector road. Patricia L. Fletcher, November 1st, 38 Hunts Point, is opposed to a connector road and is concerned about wetlands and traffic safety. November 3rd, Dr. William D'Angelo of Hunts Point Road Extension has a concern for the safety of the numerous children on Hunts Point Road Extension. November 6th, Carolyn and Gregory Woodworth of 12 Channelview Road want to minimize impacts. They have traffic concern about the beauty and ecological sensitivity of the site and the destruction of buffers in their area. October 26th, a letter to, most recently, Dr. Richard Sullivan of 72 Two Lights Road, November 10th, suggests an emergency access road without barriers and sets forth 4 positive results of such a road, which I will not enumerate at this time. John and Patricia Reed of 54 Spurwink Avenue support the revised proposal of Spurwink Woods. Deborah Friedman of 72 Spurwink Avenue support the proposal of Spurwink Woods. And John and Joanne Chanel of 214 Spurwink Avenue request a public hearing on Mr. Rummery's proposal on Spurwink Avenue before the Planning Board acts on that public access waiver. Are these more?
No more.
Oh. And, let's see. We have to Marion Guthrie, chairperson, from Greg Tinsman, removal of fill from wetland area. I will have to read this so that the date is November 21st. Building a home. Excuse me a minute. Well, I've read this very quickly, and it appears that there has been some filling, and that Mr. Tinsman is asked to come before the planning board. And I don't know how we would address this, but all I can say is that when there is filling of wetlands, drainage problems can occur on adjacent lots. And Steve, I don't know how we can address this, but it is my feeling, after sitting on the Wetlands Ordinance Committee, that the sooner any damage to wetlands is done, the sooner we can fix that, the better it is, because of concerns for drainage problems. So if you could address this week, you know, I don't know the process, but it would be nice if there were someone who could act immediately on rectifying the situation and cleaning up, you know, any damage to the wetlands that has occurred.
I'm not sure that can be done, and we can talk about it now or
well,
at the end
it
of
isn't,
the meeting.
This isn't an agenda item,
no,
so, you know, I just hope that we can address this, you know, as soon as possible. Okay? I'll talk with you about it tomorrow. Okay, first on the agenda, the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 24-lot major subdivision application. Tonight we are addressing the completeness issue and also probably discussing the preliminary plan. So would you like to come up, Mr. Kennedy? And I think you've made a change. Or
Marion,
yes.
As I have done in the past, I'm going to refrain from being involved in this. I'd like to do something different than I have in the past, and that is just sit here so I can at least read this letter about the wetlands fill and maybe listen. But my presence here has nothing to do with any participation.
And in your absence, I would like to appoint Judith Wyman as a voting member on this proposal. Okay, go ahead, Mr. Grinsko. How are you tonight?
I'm here. Madam Chairman, if you
yes.
prefer another representative, you can accomplish that very quickly by dealing with the issue of completeness. Because once we get into the merits of the application, unless legal questions arise, you won't see me again. But
okay.
The first issue, I think, for the board, at least the way your agenda is laid out,
yes.
is the completeness issue. On October 17th, you presented us with your specific detail request and materials. We believe that all of those materials have been submitted both in the November 3rd submission and then in the additional materials which you received as a result of your workshop session.
Mm-hmm.
If there are any materials still missing, as required by the ordinance, I would love to know what they are.
Okay, I will call upon our planner to address the completion issue if you want to start immediately with that.
Well, that's up to you folks. I thought that was the first item on the agenda.
No, that's okay. Go ahead, Steve.
Okay, first off, we'll get to the good news for the applicant, which he already knows. That is that having talked very recently, in fact, yesterday with the town attorney, it appears as though two items that I had marked partial, because I hadn't heard from the town attorney, appear to be complete. And those two items will be on the second page, 13B, deed restriction description. Given the fact that there are still a lot of questions related to this 25-foot right-of-way that goes through the northern parcel, the Phase 2 parcel of the proposed subdivision, but the town attorney feels that the information that's been submitted meets the completeness requirement, although there are still lots of questions dealing with what the actual impacts are of the right-of-way to on the design of the subdivision. So 13B, I would recommend changing from a partial to an okay.
Okay, we're going to cross off partial and put okay.
Then at the bottom of the page, the last item, which is unnumbered, evidence of right title and interest, for that, the same reason I just described, that also would, I'd recommend that be changed from a partial to an okay. Again, right now, the applicant has submitted enough information to deal with the complete, you know, to make the application complete. Again, there are a lot of issues that come up. The subdivision issue was another thing, the re-subdivision issue, I'm sorry.
Right.
It's another issue that needs to be addressed, but in terms of completeness, it appears to be okay.
Right.
In terms of the 10A, going back down through the list, and we're getting down to some minor points for the most part. 10A, there's the question of where the actual pedestrian easement was located. And that's pretty much, and I'm referring to, or when I looked at this, I was thinking of two easements in particular. One was the pedestrian easement that would go from the end of the Hunts Point Road extension up to the northern parcel, and it's shown continuing to the end of the applicant's property. The applicant had stated in the past, I believe, that easement should extend all the way to, and was going to extend all the way to Two Lights Road. That appears to be a different interpretation now, or different slant on that by the applicant. So, but at the time I was reviewing this, and now unless we hear differently from the applicant, it's still a partial, although it could become an okay. In terms of the public use land, one of the requirements in the ordinance, not so much the checklist, but the ordinance, is that the conditions that are attached to the pedestrian easements need to be described. And that hasn't been done by the applicant, as far as I could see.
Could you reference a section, please? And I'm referring to the October 17th request of the board.
And I'm referring to the ordinance that's right here.
Well, the board has made a decision as to what's been requested, and we have to review according to that decision.
That I leave to the board. So I'll go to the ordinance and describe what's there and not there.
No, I meant as to what section of request at the board, not the ordinance section, the section of the board's memorandum, so I can follow along.
First, I'm going to go to the ordinance, and I go to the memorandum.
What are you looking for, Mr. Maybe I can help you. I have my ordinance.
It's a subdivision. It's just the subdivision of appendix.
The appendix? Appendix B?
I got it. Okay, I've got it. It says, all parcels of land proposed to be dedicated to public use and the conditions of such dedication. So the conditions of the dedication haven't been shown.
Do you have the November 2nd submission to the board? Should have been in the second supplemental submission. And part of that, the condition of that easement and the details of its
right
terms are set forth.
And under K, it talks about, it's under that memorandum on K, page 2, states that the conditions relating to the pedestrian easement are not included. Conditions are still not included.
Yeah, as I said to you on page 2 of the conditions and restrictions affecting development submitted on November 2nd, that is specifically described. And that is part of the second supplemental submission.
Thank you. I'll take a look at it in a second. Thank you. I'm going along. Natural features number 18. The basic issue that remains here is, gets back to the whole question of where the true wetland boundaries are. And based on the submissions that were done earlier this month, before the site walk, they were stated as such that the site walk the next day, we saw firsthand that some additional wetlands boundaries had been added. They may or may not be, they appear to be included in the later submission, the attachment that was included in the packet that was presented by the applicant later on. But as of the submission deadline, that wasn't included. Typical cross-sections, this is a question that deals with whether or not this is needed. This is a judgment call on the planning board's part. Deals with the question of whether or not a pedestrian easement, the cross-section is needed for the easement. And I'm not, that's something I just need guidance from, or, you know, the board needs to make. The existing location appears to be, the existing pathway appears to be pretty evident. I just wanted to raise the issue in terms of the pedestrian easement itself, whether or not the board wanted anything or not. Town engineer doesn't seem all that excited about this item, so that's an issue. The last item is on, the last item that's marked partial deals with grading and landscaping plan number 22. And that's a very minor point, but in the applicant's submission, the applicant talks that on phase one, lots two and lots three, the applicant is going to provide some buffering, some additional plantings. On the plans, they show that for lot two, I believe it is, but for lot three, that doesn't appear to be on the plan. So it's minor. All they would need to do is to add it on. So that's it as in terms of my review. It's up to the board to make the decision, and it's up to the applicant or his representative to go through and identify areas which I may have missed.
Any comments from
Steve,
from questions?
Could you just review, for my benefit anyways, at least I didn't pick it up, where are you looking for planning board confirmation? What item?
Well, okay, well, it probably would be all of them, really. I mean, the decision on completeness is going to be yours. I think the question, applicant kind of talk about the points where they want to push the issue. But I'd say the one which is crystal clear would be in terms of the typical cross-section. I mean, that's again, relatively minor, and it may not be necessary. Others in terms of location of easements, you may either hear something from the applicant tonight, or you just may feel that the information that's been provided is enough for now, and the substance of the issue may need to be hammered out later on.
So, Steve, did I hear really that it's item 18, the natural features?
I'd say it's pretty much item 18, natural features.
That didn't make the deadline.
Didn't make the deadline, and then, that would be the major one.
Any discussion?
Madam Chairman, I've got a couple of comments, and maybe it'll save Mr. Frinsco some arguing time and clock ticking for his client. But basically, there will always be a discussion and some conflict in all of our minds, perhaps, about what is a complete application and what is an application that's so well documented that there are no further discussion points that have to occur. And in just listening to the issues that are still outstanding, perhaps the most significant issue, and perhaps the only significant issue in my mind, is the natural features, the true wetlands. But even here, I would have to say that the applicant has submitted documentation where the wetlands are. Whether or not additional wetlands are found through further research, or the town's own analysis of wetland showing additional wetland areas, is something for our technical discussion during the review process. And I guess I say that partially for that reason, because I think there'll always be a conflict about what's a complete application. I personally feel that this is a complete application. I do have a question about the letter that we sent, which Mr. Frinsco began to talk about, and whether or not all of those issues have data submitted on them. Not that they're technically complete, but are all of the issues addressed in that letter sufficient for us to initiate the technical review process? I say it partially for that reason, but partially because I spent a couple of hours the other night with a resident in that area who is very much concerned that they're not being given the opportunity to have some input through the public hearing process into the plan, and now we're 3 months beyond when the original application was submitted. It's our intent, It's the town's intent to have a public hearing process as early in the process as possible so that interested parties can have some say and input. And the basis for the complete plan is that they have enough to react to and to make comment on as they support or object to provisions of a plan. And I would think that it's time to cut off the process and anticipating that all of the issues that were in your letter of last month have been addressed. Move toward a complete plan so that we can initiate that technical discussion, which we've been held up on to this point. Whether it's all there or not, I think, is not the issue. Whether it is there sufficient to allow us technical review, I think, is the real question.
Thank you.
So I also asked the question whether or not they've addressed all of the issues that were in your letter last month.
Mm-hmm. What do you think, Steve?
I would say if whether they've asked technically or whether or not there's one or, you know, if there are minor issues that are still outstanding, there are one or two minor issues that are outstanding. And the question that the board has to ask themselves is whether or not the wetlands information's there enough so that you feel you can begin substantive review.
Well, it's basically the wetlands issue is the only one that you're really questioning at this point, Steve.
I'm sorry?
The wetlands issue is the only one that's being questioned really at this point.
Right. I think as long as some of the other items are dealt with, you know, are included next time around, yes. But I guess in terms of I view my job as reviewing the completeness checklist very strictly and letting you then make those judgment calls. I guess my feeling is, though, if there's some items that are missing, that the board feels are missing, to me it doesn't totally preclude a discussion of the substance of the item. It does preclude setting the date for a public hearing, however. I want to raise that point as well.
Yes, I believe that since we have hired, in effect, our own wetlands specialist to look into the definition of these wetlands, that we really are going to be well covered as far as having some very in-depth analysis of the wetlands, so I feel that that's not a great problem. I did want to ask a question as to the appropriateness of the consideration of the re-subdivision of the plan, whether that matter should be settled before we go on with an application completeness, or I guess, Steve, can you address that? I cannot find anything from Mr. Leahy responding to that.
Tom's office was doing research late last week, early this week, on this issue. And so instead of getting something writing, they did it verbally and can follow up with something writing. The basic feeling was that this re-subdivision issue is definitely there. It has to be dealt with by the applicant. But in terms of completeness, Tom's office felt that it did not affect completeness, but it was something that the board really needed to look at, that the applicant really needed to come up with, and the town attorney probably needed to talk a little bit further about this issue, and the ramifications in terms of the preliminary and final plan approval, there's going to be an effect on that. Because the idea is that it is a re-subdivision of the Hunts Point Road extension subdivision that was approved a few years back, and that certain conditions, that the board may be able to put certain conditions on that, if the board feels that's necessary. So I guess in a nutshell, for now, the news is that the resubdivision issue is there, but Tom feels that it can be folded in to the Highlands Broad Cove development, perhaps not as easily as the applicant's attorney suggests, but that it can be done.
Any other questions or comments? My concern is that when applicants come before us, we do have deadlines for submissions. And if this additional information that came in on the wetlands did not make the deadline, I think it just sets a precedent and, you know, people have to make deadlines. So that's the one little nitpicky thing that I'm concerned about. Do I hear a motion?
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I will make a motion that we consider it a complete application. But I want to address the point that you make, because I think that it's a very important one, that there will be still discussions about wetlands and whether they are appropriately located. Now, we went out on a site walk to out of sequence. We don't usually do that until application completeness. The applicant agreed to go out on a site walk so that we'd have a better feel for the site. We walked through some area that wasn't mapped as wetlands, and we got our feet wet, and we said, would you take a look at this? They did. They had their people take a look at it right after that. They submitted another map that showed that area. Yes, in fact, that was wetlands. And I think we're going to have that in this application, and I think we will have this, that, and other applications where a technical advisor misses a small piece of land as wetland. I think our point should be that it's seen, taken care of, addressed as part of the issues of not necessarily application completeness, but technical review and then approval or disapproval or approval with conditions of an applicant, an application. So I think we're always going to have that, and I would hope that as we go out on our site walks, one of the things that we're looking at is those kind of issues. That doesn't mean that the application is incomplete. It means that it's an error, and that it has to be corrected before we approve the plan. So I'm not as concerned by that. I think we've gone further in this application than in most before it's deemed to be complete. I think that there's a lot of feeling about this application in the town that I'm anxious to see get out into the open.
I think you're absolutely right.
And start dealing with the issues. I want to start talking about roads and whether they're fully access roads or whether they are partially access roads, as one of the letters indicates tonight. And I guess we all have to come down on the basis, is it a complete application sufficient so that we can start the process, or is it an incomplete application where they've just missed the point or missed information completely? And I think if they showed one little wetland area, we could deem it to be complete and then turn it down as an application if they didn't
provide
that,
us with the
that data.
Right.
So with that as a background, I will move that we order that the preliminary plan application of the Greater Portland Development Group, Inc. for Highlands at Broad Cove, a proposed 22-lot subdivision located off Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Channel View Road, and Two Lights Road, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 16.2.4 and Appendix B of the Subdivision Ordinance, the application completeness checklist, and the facts presented. Be it further ordered that a public hearing on this proposed subdivision will be held at the board's regular December meeting, December 19th.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Tinsman's motion.
I second it.
Any discussion? Hearing none, I will call for a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The application has been deemed complete. And now, think that we could just kind of extend our workshop, and perhaps you could tell us about, but you know, one thing, while you are here, I don't want to put you on the spot. No, I'm not putting you on the spot. This is something I'm not asking you, Mr. Frinsco, to answer tonight, but I'm very interested in the law. I really wish that I had gone to law school. But as I was doing my homework last Sunday on this particular project, I looked up, this is the only Maine planning and land use laws pamphlet that I have. It is dated 1988. And I just have a question.
First of all, you want to get a new one.
I know it.
But please, let me see if I can answer
your question. Maybe it's changed, you know,
so.
But you don't have to answer me now. This is just a question. A subdivision is the division of a tract or parcel of land into three or more lots within a five-year period, okay? Then, on the next page, you see why I went to these this pamphlet is because, as I've read the materials on this Mr. Kennedy subdivision, the people who are reporting in the materials call this two parcels. You know, it's again and again, it is referred to as two parcels. So I went on and I read on page 21, the amateur attorney. For the purposes of this section, a tract or parcel of land is defined as all contiguous land in the same ownership, provided that lands located on opposite sides of a public or private road shall be considered each a separate tract. That means two subdivisions, or parcel of land, unless such road was established by the owner of land on both sides thereof. Mm-hmm. I don't understand that. And, you know, I don't know if we're doing one subdivision or two. And it's just a point of curiosity.
You're being asked to approve the subdivision of two parcels of land in one application.
Uh-huh. And that can be done?
Oh, surely. This fact is done quite regularly. What we have here, however, is that we do have an ownership of land which joins the two parcels to Hunts Point Road. Since the applicant owns the fee in the roadway,
I see,
which is shown as the little, the short connector
right.
streets.
I've seen that roadway, and he
but
owns
technically,
the
since
fee.
since Hunts Point Road was not created by this applicant, they are two parcels of land. That particular section was placed in the law for a reason not related to this subdivision application at all, but it was placed there to determine whether or not you would be considered. Land on both sides of the road would be considered separate parcels for starting the count as to whether you divided into three lots. If you had land on both sides of the road and you split one, mm-hmm. do you have three lots then, or do you have two lots on one side and one on the other? The answer is, if you've created the road, you got three lots. If you haven't created the road, you only have two lots up here and one lot down here, and no subdivision approval is required. However, since we've got more than three on both sides of the road, it's clear that we do need approval.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I didn't mean to put you on the spot. Mr. Kennedy, would you like to explain what you have done with the channel view change?
Yes, why don't I have Scott Decker explain the changes in the configuration of the roadway and the lots.
As you can see from the plans I'll be showing you, the roadway and the lot layouts are evolving as we meet with the board each month. The initial subdivision that we brought before you 2 or 3 months ago showed this roadway and lot configuration. And it basically, very briefly, it showed a through road from Two Lights through to Winding Way, another through road from Hunts Point Road Extension through to Channel View with a small cul-de-sac off the through road. At a meeting a month or so ago, we came to you with an alternate A. This layout was very much the same as the original layout in the Phase 2 area, but in the Phase 1 area, we eliminated a section of road and made the through road from Two Lights through to Hunts Point Road Extension, and we're planning to provide access to these three lots in Phase 1 through private roads and requesting an access waiver. What we're planning or proposing at this point in time, based on comments received at the workshop session, is a variation in the concept A, which we're now calling an alternate B. and we're eliminating very little change and actually no change in the phase one area. We're revising the phase two area somewhat to eliminate the through road from Hunts Point through to Channel View Road. What we plan to do is put in the maximum length of cul-de-sac allowed by the ordinance, and then put in a private road or requiring a public access waiver to service the lots in this area. There are six or seven lots there. One lot would be serviced from Channel View Road with a private drive, the remainder off from this road here. We have eliminated one lot from the previous submittal. We now are talking 15 lots rather than the 16 we had before. Also on this drawing, we are showing a little bit different perimeter on the wetland. We have had the ecologists back in the field, have flagged the boundary of the wetlands, and have had a surveyor go out and locate the flagging. So you'll notice that the boundary is very irregular compared to what it was shown on the previous plan. And basically, that's what we're proposing at this point in time. We acknowledge Mr. Hunter's comments and have been a little reluctant to get into those in detail until we get the roadway layout nailed down. A lot of his comments relate to details of the final design, and once we get a roadway layout, we'll go in and solve those issues.
Thank you. Any comments or questions?
How many lots does that private road now serve? I didn't look at the plan in detail.
This road here?
Yeah.
Sure.
The public access way you're going to go for, how many lots?
There would be a total of six lots. You'll have one, two, three, four, five, six. Lot two could be serviced off the cul-de-sac, but that would also require a waiver on the 200-foot frontage requirement, so that there would be six lots.
Could you tell me where lot 16 is in Mr. Hunter's letter, enumeration number 5? The driveway is sketched for lot 16 appears to encroach on the wetlands more than necessary. This is his November 15th letter.
Well, we don't have the drive shown here. I suspect that the drive probably came in over here, and what he's suggesting is we move the drive away from this section of wetland. This here was lot 16.
And you've eliminated that?
Well, we've combined and reconfigured the lot somewhat. It's basically the same configuration with a different lot number at this point in time. I think what Mr. Hunter is referring to is why don't we move the drive as we've shown it away from the wetland,
which
could be done.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Since we have a completed plan, we will be setting a public hearing for December 16th, and I would hope that you would have 19th. I'm sorry. It would be at our next planning board meeting on December 19th. And I'm sure there will be many questions from the public, and I would hope that Mr. Decker would be here. And I am particularly interested in having Mr. Bray here, because traffic and impacts on neighborhoods with this proposed plan have got to be totally investigated. I think that the people of Cape Elizabeth, the people who have come here tonight, should know that what the planning board really counts on a public hearing. And oftentimes after a public hearing, during the preliminary plan approval process, there are changes made to plans. And we just need a lot more information. So I would be very, I think I spoke with you at the workshop meeting about my questions on traffic, which would include ones that I listed today. the impacts on Hunts Point Road, the impacts on Broad Cove Road. I guess I would be asking the traffic person that if this indeed did connect to two lights, is there any way of knowing if there might be more traffic on Broad Cove Road? You know, maybe he can't answer questions like that. Impacts on all other roads in Broad Cove, including Salt Spray Lane, which I think is a very dangerous road. It's got a hill, it has a ravine, and I've almost been on in two head-on collisions there because I'm so busy looking at the view that I've almost run into a couple of cars there. And definitely on Two Lights Road. I took the time last week to call Judy Scott of Two Lights State Park. And I asked, how many cars, you know, go to the state park? I'm really concerned about that because there's a state park there. There is a restaurant that is very popular, and there is scenic beauty and two lights. So according to, they do not count cars, which was of interest to me, but they do count people. And in 1988, 51,536 people went to Two Lights Park. And I was told by Mr. Scott that you could figure out the cars if you divided that number by 2.5 persons. And I don't have a calculator, I just do math. I think it's right. That means 20,614.4 cars, but that was just from May 1st through September 30th. The park is open year-round, but and off-season is just an estimate made by rangers. And this year, they were down a little bit. They only had 20,128.4 cars. So I think I would be interested in questions like that, and especially about the intersection from Two Lights, the intersection that meets from Two Lights Road to Route 77. There is a curve there. You know, I would just like an awful lot of information on all of that, and I won't keep talking. I'll let someone else.
Madam Chair, I just want to add your traffic request to those that Bob Hunter asked on item 12 for some site distance information on Channelview Road. So that might be also something that we might want to address.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chairman, just yes. To point out, in terms of the public access waiver, if under the current standards, if an access waiver serves more than three or more lots, it has to meet town subdivision road standards. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming that the applicant is then going to ask for a waiver of those standards so as to minimize the impact on wetlands. So I just want to point that fact out. That may need to be done. And if not, the applicant may not be saving all that much.
And you know, I mean, if we do think that there are negative impacts on any of these roads, any that I mentioned, then I guess the applicant would have to be prepared to tell us how these impacts would be mitigated. Anything else? Mr. Tinsman?
Madam Chairman, we had a letter from Mr. Sullivan and several others that talked about a limited access, emergency access to Broad Cove. And this board has talked about with the applicant a number of proposals that were of a partial, originally proposed emergency access with a gated structure at some location along it. We've talked to the chiefs of police and fire in a workshop session and the commissioner of public works. And I think at the workshop session, we heard our staff calling for a full-time access for emergency vehicles both in and out of Broad Cove, and that's appropriate. And mm-hmm. I think most people are indicating now that either live in the area or are involved in the town. I'm talking about a full-time, not a temporary gated emergency access point or access point. Mr. Sullivan's letter, though, proposes something different than we have previously talked about. And that was not a gated emergency access point, but an access point that is fully serviceable, plowable, usable, open, and yet not a full public road. And I would think that we would want to give some consideration to that. It seems like a very nice compromise between a full access point for Broad Cove being fully used and the requirement for an emergency access, which is a principal public safety concern by this town for any subdivision that is served only by one road. I was very pleased with seeing that as a possible compromise. I don't know how it would be implemented. I think we'd need to look at that and whether or not there are any problems that result from it. But you know, even if we did that, we might have a similar configuration to what is being proposed, whatever scheme is chosen, and then maybe just not the full development of the road. So that offers interesting opportunities that I think at some point this board will need to talk to the applicant about and to the public safety people in town.
Yes, and in the past, roads are just one integral part of a plan. The planning board has to look at the whole plan, and sometimes roads are proposed, but until we have all of the information on the wetlands, on the impacts of neighborhoods, on the traffic safety, intersections, it's an exercise in futility to really go in depth on how those roads would be. We have to wait to see how the whole thing is going to come together. So this is definitely something that we will be discussing in the future, and no stone will be left unturned on roads, wetlands, or anything. Any other comments?
Madam Chairman, also, this is the first time we've seen alternate B, and it resulted from our workshop meeting where we talked about one of our ordinance provisions is to discourage through traffic through neighborhoods. And the concept was raised about not taking Heritage Court, if that's the name of the road, through to Channel View Road.
Right.
And thereby not crossing the wetland that all of a sudden appeared on some of the maps in that area. So it's the first time we've seen this and on the board there, but that's going to be a tough one as well, because the road stops at some point, and then a private road, whether it's full subdivision standards or whatever it might be, is a very long road in excess of 600 feet by itself. Didn't we originally have a proposal from the applicant that had two cul-de-sacs in phase two, but didn't include that long, thin road?
I think we did.
And I don't know how that was accomplished. Maybe that road was more than 1,000 feet in length. I don't have that plan still, so I don't know how that was done.
I'm sure there are many ways this could be done. There is, as Mr. Prinsko pointed out, a right-of-way at the edge of the property in phase two that could conceivably be used as a right-of-way to Farm Pond Road, at least on the maps that I'm looking at.
Down here?
No, phase two. No, put way over next to the farm. There is a right-of-way that runs up from Hunts Point Road on the side of the property.
Here?
No, north of there.
That's it.
It is?
The one that goes at a right angle to Hunts Point Road?
Yes. Yeah. There is a right-of-way there.
This right-of-way?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
we could use several of those right-of-ways for driveways. They're sprinkled all around the site, if that's your preference. Some of them have 40 feet of frontage, some of them, one of them has 20 feet. Depends on what the board feels would be more appropriate to access a lot of these.
Excuse me, what was the site distance like on that Hunts Point?
At the end?
Yeah, on the right-of-way.
On the right-of-way itself?
Going out towards Two Lights.
The site distance right here?
No, out on the road.
Out here on Two Lights?
Mm-hmm.
I looked at it again tonight. There is a slight curve, but I think you can see that driver's height for 250, 300 feet. On going to the north, you can see over 1,000 feet going to the south.
I don't think that I've described to you the right thing, and I don't have the proper glasses to see that, so, no. I think I saw a right-of-way on the map that runs down from Phase 2 and runs perpendicular to Hunts Point Road.
Well, there's a right-of-way right here, 20 feet, 50 feet, and 40 feet.
Thank you. I just can't see it. Okay, that's what I'm talking about. Thanks, Steve just pointed that out.
Be the 40-foot easement at the end of Huntsburg Road Extension.
Steve just, that we're talking about the same thing.
Would it be used as a driveway?
Well, it could also be used as a road to access.
It doesn't meet the standard of 50 feet right away.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's been waived before.
What would you like to say?
Any other comments?
Plus, it goes through a wetland, too.
Oh.
At least on the new map, the one that you can't see, Marianne, shows some green through half of that.
Anything else? Well, then, we thank you for coming tonight. If you have no questions, the public hearing will be on December 19th. Okay?
Thank you very much.
And for the applicant and for the public's information, the submission deadline for that meeting is December 1st, Friday.
Could we send the Mr. Sullivan's letter to the fire chief and police chief for review?
Sure.
and comment?
Sure. It's Dr. Sullivan.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda is Spurwink Woods and I have the appearance of a conflict of interest here, so I will be leaving and turning the meeting over to our host.
Is the applicant prepared for presentation on any changes to the plan?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Why don't you go ahead?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you for receiving us tonight. Just to step back and recoup where we were a month ago, we had a proposal before this board for the project on Spurwink Ave, which we're identifying as Spurwink Woods.
Would it be possible to move that a little bit further?
Sure.
Before this? I don't know if it's just me. I don't want to...
We've got some glare and shadows there, yeah.
Is that any better?
It's much better.
Far better for me.
Is that okay?
Can everybody on the board see it now?
Even Mary can see it.
Oh, if you would pardon me one second. I just forgot one important step. We do have one person shy. We're not voting on this issue, but I would appoint Steve Edsel for this time. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. As I was saying, a month ago, we were before the board with the same piece of land, looking at a project that had two accesses serving 26 to 27 lots. Accesses off of Spurwink Avenue at this point here, and through the site, accessing again on Macaulay Road. And to save some time and detail, I think at this point the board and ourselves, of course, are pretty familiar with the project and the details of what it looks like. After that meeting, I think we received some pretty strong comments and some good comments from the board, and we took those to heart and regrouped and looked at the issues that we had and the parameters that we were working with. And as we mentioned to the board at that last meeting, we were in the process of having our wetlands on site flagged at the very day that we were at that meeting, and would have them mapped soon afterwards. At this point, the plan that you, I assume, have in front of you and that you see here tonight has the wetlands as flagged by eco-analysts of Bath, Maine, and mapped by our survey crews from Land Use Consultants. And the wetlands, as you see them, I'll point to the outline of them, are down along in this low depression near Spurwink Avenue and drain on northward towards what they call, I guess, the Spurwink Marsh, approximately a quarter to a half mile north of there. There's also a wetland finger that was identified by the botanists up in this area here, which is, as we believe, or the botanists believe, is pretty much isolated in a slightly different elevation. This wetland down here, it appears to drain to a culvert at the Macaulay Road subdivision at that point there. There was also identified by the botanists to our surprise, a small wetland pocket, approximately 150 feet in length at this point right here. So in essence, we have wetlands at this point here, here, and here now that we're working with. And the issues before us last time, we had proposed crossing the wetlands in order to gain access off of Spurwink Avenue. In light of the fact that the wetlands now have basically grown on us and are much larger than we had first anticipated, we propose now to come off of a single access off Macaulay Road so that we don't have to cross the wetlands and cause any disturbance to that whole area down in this portion of the site. And the proposal we have before you tonight, as I mentioned, we have a minor street, 24-foot pavement is proposed, with a single access off Macaulay Road opposite Chevers Road. That access coming into the site breaks into two roads. The first road here, we identify as Road A, is approximately 1,040 feet in length. And at this point here, we break off into another road with a T-type turnaround, which is approximately 480 feet in length. And this road here would be serviced by a cul-de-sac. And the merits of the plan, as we look at the plan tonight, I think there's some serious and significant merits to what this plan offers as compared to the previous plan. Firstly, the layout of the site offers the residents of Spurwink Avenue basically a natural buffer of approximately 500-600 feet across the marsh, which is entirely wooded from this point back, so that they're basically segregated from the project. This entire piece of land here would be dedicated open space, dedicated to a conservation trust or other appropriate group. And the client, or the developer, has also offered to these abutters along Spurwink Avenue a strip of land in this area in here that he would donate land in that area to those direct abutters to increase their respective lot sizes. And what we had proposed is that in order to access this piece of this parcel open space in here, a 15-foot right-of-way access be proposed at this point here off of Spurwink Avenue. In addition, we propose a buffer behind these lots and through here. There would be a deeded buffer on these lots, basically providing a green belt between these abutters and the houses that are back in the subdivision over here. And although it's not clear on this plan, there's a separate open space parcel in this area here, which would effectively then give an open space or a green space area, buffering the entire project from the residential neighborhood in this area here. As well, we propose that this portion of the project, which is right now a continuous piece of the parcel, the 24-acre parcel shown here, this portion here be presented as an open space parcel with a subdivision as well. And again, we provided an access easement from the main roadway right here. And thirdly, just in terms of the layout of the site, I think what this type of a layout has to offer is Again, there are 16 lots. And as you enter the main access road through here, you essentially, again, you can see that the lots are approximately 25,000 plus square feet in size. And given the size of the residential neighborhoods around here, they are at least as big or slightly larger than most of the lots around there. But I think the real beauty to the layout is that you have a wooded entrance. You've got the town wooded lot right here, which basically buffers these lots right here. They have a natural buffer behind them. And again, we're proposing a buffer in this area here and here.
Can you just explain to me, you have a wooded entryway with a little bit of green on either side of it.
And an existing dwelling right here.
And how about on the other side?
This is the town-owned parcel.
What's in the white thing where you're painting right now?
This is the town-owned parcel right here.
So that's green.
It's a green bay, green spot, yes. And these are occupied lots over here. And as you enter the site and beyond these homes in here, you basically enter into a buffered area that, again, as I mentioned, it would be a green belt or a green parcel right here. But in effect, although this area here and here is occupied by land within lots as proposed, if one were to walk the site, which we did and took a very close look at the topography and the ledge outcrops and the hard and soft wood stands of trees, which was basically, that is how the road was derived as you see it, you end up with basically a very large area of natural wooded area in through here that segregates this portion of the project from this portion of the project up here, and I think would, from the visual aspect, would really present itself well in terms of buffering both the people in this area here from this portion of the subdivision as well as these people here from the abutters here. I may add that this area in through here is entirely wooded back in through here. Secondly, what we propose in terms of this layout is that the main access road here we propose a reduced frontages on a pork chop or hammerhead type lots, if you excuse the terminology. At this point here, these are both 50-foot frontage lots that extend back into here with a common drive or limited access waiver into these lots here. And secondly, along this roadway here, the same sort of a scenario with a reduced frontage lot right here with a common driveway to access these two lots. And in addition, in terms of the layout last time, we had talked about the septic design and the fact that since the moratorium is still in effect in town, we would be proposing a common sewer system for the entire project. Again, we propose the same sort of a sewer system here, a common septic system for the entire project. There was some discussion last time about the need for a reserve area and that the previous project didn't allow a large enough area for a possible reserve should the primary leach fields fail. This proposal offers a much larger area, approximately an acre and a half of land, which we have done some preliminary design, would be capable of supporting a primary and reserve, if you will, septic systems should the primary systems fail. And I think from an aesthetic standpoint, I think one of the issues that sometimes gets overlooked and it presents itself well in a case like this is that this area, although utilized, as I'm sure you've seen in previous projects, for a septic system, ends up being pretty much a grassed area. So again, from a buffered standpoint, these lots back in here have an open area between them and the nearest lot via the wetlands in this area here and the grassed area in here. Again, basically providing a more of a secluded and buffered area back in through here. And I think before the board right now, we would, with this layout strictly as shown here, we would be asking again for limited access waivers as noted. In addition, a waiver of the road length for just slightly over 1,000 feet, again, 1,040 feet. I think we could actually pull the road back. I'll offer this to the board that the reason this is just over 1,000 feet is because of the topography. I think as you enter the site in through here, these houses are actually lower than the roadway. You've got a natural stand of trees and the rock outcrops, which again naturally buffers these lots, these homes from this roadway here. And as you climb in through here, you're climbing up a small ledge incline of about a 10-foot rise in the ledge, which is why the cul-de-sac was pulled just over 1,000 feet. When the obvious question may be, if it's 1,040 feet and you have to ask for a waiver, why not make it 1,000 feet? And that's the reason. We would otherwise have to pull the cul-de-sac back and put it on a sloping area, which would require more ledge cuts. I hesitate, in a sense, to ask this before the board, but we've also taken a look at, and I'd like to just throw this before the board, since this is discussional nature, an alternative layout to this that's very similar, but it addresses the issue of the roads. It's the same sort of a layout with a single access. Again, I don't mean to confuse the board or throw a lot of information in front of the board that might seem superfluous, but if there's an issue with the road layout as such, where we have basically 1,500 feet of road on the previous layout, this is basically the same sort of a layout. However, the road, with an additional lot, there would be an additional lot, the possibility of an additional lot in here, this common septic system, et cetera, limited access waivers in through here. But with a single access, again, with a single roadway, the roadway length would be more like 1,300 feet as opposed to 1,000 feet, again, requiring a waiver from the board and for approximately 300 feet over the 1,000-foot limit. Again, we have proposed that as in our discussing the project amongst ourselves as an alternative that may have its merits.
You still would have a public access waiver requirement on that one, too, wouldn't you, at the end?
Yes, we would.
So you'd come off the cul-de-sac with some, with another...
A reduced access waiver here as well as, I think, this lot right here, 1, 2, 3.
Mr. Chairman, we've had a lot of discussion about 1,000 feet versus 1,500 feet and 1,800 feet, and maybe Steve Butler could review for us some of his research and recommendations to the board. The second alternative appears to be a lot better design than the first. And when you look at two roads going in and properties abutted on two sides by a public road, that's strange. That's a strange type of subdivision proposal. And we may have a similar kind of issue with Highlands at Broad Cove, with 1,000 feet going in, then a very long road out of that. So maybe we could talk for a few minutes about why we have a 1,000-foot restriction and whether that makes sense, or whether in special cases with the property that we have, if it should be varied.
If I'm not mistaken, we started at 500 feet, and that was modified, so that now we're at 1,000.
Right. The ordinance provision says that the length of a dead-end street shall be 500 feet, but that can be extended up to 1,000 feet if topographic conditions or if a better site design results, comes out of the extension up to 1,000. And so that's where things stand now. I think the 1,000-foot standard, by a couple different sources, but one deals with the average, and that just may now be outdated, but the length of a fire hose, that if you had, for some reason, you had a blockage at your entrance to the dead-end road and couldn't get a fire truck in there, let's say, that you could still somehow be able to hook up. There are people on the board who know more about fire hoses than I do. But you could be able to then still get a hose up to a site and adequately provide fire protection. The other concern is, beyond a certain distance, again, if the hypothetical tree falls at the entrance or the hypothetical oil truck kind of jackknifes, in terms of an ambulance getting up to a certain area, it might be a problem far along, especially in the wintertime. I think those are the major issues. And so there's a provisions in here to deal with length and also the maximum number of houses to be served.
Of course, in Broad Cove, we deal with miles, not feet.
That's true. One of the reasons why we're pushing for a second access.
Mr. Chairman, if comments are appropriate, the alternative B is much more palatable to me from a design standpoint, rather than having the two roads go in, looks like a stick man. Built on the property, but I think that's going to require this analysis of the 1,000-foot maximum for a road, and that's going to require some hard analysis, I think, based on the number of people and the risks and all of that.
And a number of trips that could be generated. Yeah. You are planning a redundant system in the lot. Is it still Lot 5 that's going to be your sewer lot, so to speak?
Yes, this lot here, I apologize for not mentioning that. It was unintentional. That on the previous, let me back up to this plan here. I guess
it's easy is it still in the same location, A or B? Is the same location?
This lot right here?
Yeah.
Yes, it is. And for use for common septic. The idea with this lot as well, as I mentioned, the moratorium on the sewer precludes us from obtaining a sewer connection for the site, as you're well aware. That this lot, in either case, would be provided with 200 feet of frontage with the intent that should sewer be accessible or sewer moratorium be lifted and we be allowed to connect to the sewer during the design process, et cetera, at some point, these could actually be two building lots. So in other words, in terms of consideration of the roadway in future design, if that were to become a reality, this would be an extra two lots here, and the same with the other layout, an extra two lots.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, just as a point of order, I just want to clarify that there isn't a sewer moratorium in effect. It's the current sewer ordinance, it's very restrictive in terms of new hookups.
Right. There is no moratorium, that's right.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
I have a question on previous plans of this had also a common sewer area. But wasn't it that in that plan, Lot 15, what's Lot 15 now? Right on the corner? And I believe it was had been soils tested for 27 lots at the time.
Yeah, we proposed the same, the geometry of the site and the layout of the site, of course, is different, but the same area, what we have here, it's difficult to see, but there's a ledge knolling through here which drops down to the wetlands, another ledge knolling through here. The favorable soils on site are basically in this vicinity here. The layout of that previous septic system, I believe, was somewhere on a corner lot right in through here.
Has this proposed common site been tested?
Yes, it has been.
How many sites? Approvable for how many beds?
We have, the way that the code works, we have done testing of the area itself, and the way the code works is if you find an area large enough, then you can design the system based on the type of soils. And so basically we're limited by the physical constraints of where we found the soils. Mm-hmm. And that area happens to be in this area right in here.
Approximately how many beds will that, or have you gone that far in your research?
If I understand the question right, we have designed a system that would encompass right here that would easily take in 16 to 20 households based on 3 bedrooms per household.
Okay, but you were talking about the alternative site for future replacement.
This would encompass both the primary and the reserve system. So there's an area here, basically, if you will, the...
I guess my question is, are we talking about 32 sites that can be approved in there, or are we talking about 16 now?
No, only 16 if a reserve system would be required. In other words, this has the capacity in terms of square footage and area based on the soils we've found to have leach beds and configurations of leach beds designed for a, say, 16 to 20 homes. Should those fail, there's also capacity. In other words, when this is constructed, half of this would be left wooded forever, possibly, or for 20 years or 30 years or whatever. Should those fail, there is sufficient area to go back in and put an entirely new system of the same sizing.
Oh, so you're not proposing a redundant system. You're proposing enough space to...
Enough space for a redundant system. Okay. That's a detail that, again, could be worked out at the preliminary stage if it was felt by the town that a redundant system would be a safety check they would like to see. I think that's worth the merits of a discussion of that.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I'd just like to ask if you might address some of the concerns that we received in a letter that was sent to us along with minutes of a previous board meeting. And I believe, do you have a copy of that?
This was a letter.
This was to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board from a number of neighbors who were concerned about the traffic. You have a copy of that? And how Mitchell Road had previously, 6 years ago, been considered to be at 90% of its capacity, and that there are a number of accidents that have taken place out on Mitchell Road. You don't have a copy of that?
No, we do not.
It might be a good idea to get a copy.
I think you should have a copy of that. But at any rate, I think that will be a concern of the board as to the traffic impact on Mitchell Road, the fact that we had previous information that Mitchell Road had reached 90% of its capacity.
I might also make a comment that another project that we're looking at tonight involves additional lots on top of this, which will also access onto Mitchell Road. And I just ask that when we do our traffic studies, that I hope that the traffic engineers are understanding that we also have in the pipeline of lots of phase four and the
and
additional...
And as well as the addition of Meadowview, which
Meadowview.
Is a recent...
I take it we would get a traffic review with an application.
Absolutely, I think.
We deal with those questions, and I think you're hearing that the questions are going to be asked, I think, in a fairly tough manner, because that's an area that we've been concerned about for a long time.
We are equally concerned, and I think it absolutely you could expect a traffic impact analysis of that in this entire area. And as a point well taken a second ago, the comment about projects in the pipeline. I think that's well taken, and I know that the consultants we use generally do consider projects in the pipeline for in considering future development, and we would encourage them to do so.
Possibly we can take some small amount of comfort from the fact that the developer lives on Mitchell Road, so I'm not sure that that means anything, but if I lived on Mitchell Road, I wouldn't want to do anything to add an unreasonable amount of traffic, but we'll look with I think it was some anticipation at the traffic report. I think that the septic or the subsurface disposal system, although we have done it before, is going to raise questions. And I think it's important that that our engineer understand exactly in some detail what you're proposing, because I would look very very closely at any recommendations that he makes. And my initial reaction is that we would look very closely at a backup system and not necessarily just a wooded area.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, I guess I'll just comment. I understand, I remember from the last plan, that you had a road coming in from Spurwink. Did you move that because you discovered a wetland subsequently? Or have you moved that as a result of discussions and negotiations with the neighbors?
We moved that, in all honesty, because some of the comments from the board gave us a little enlightenment on the board's policy towards wetlands in terms of a special permit. As you know, we all know that would be a special permit required from the planning board. But we honestly didn't, again, they were being mapped at the same time we were going to that meeting, as they were being flagged that week by our project, survey group. We expected the wetlands to be approximately this large, and we found out how large they were. Considering the regulatory process with the special permit, the impact in terms of wildlife impact, which would have to be analyzed, the impact in terms of wetland crossing with or fill with Army Corps, we decided that that's the whole bag of worms, that if we can avoid doing it, the net gain in terms of the extra road length, in terms of the marginal loss that would be obtained, because obviously now these lots are not buildable as we originally had thought up front. I think that the merit of doing that and the economics of doing that crossing become much less tangible.
It looked to me from the correspondence, and there was a lot of it, and most of it was praising the new design. It looked as though the neighbors had expressed a strong desire to not connect up with Spurwink, and I guess I find that interesting, because we're seeing a pattern, which is neighborhoods not wanting to be connected up with major thoroughfares, and I guess I can't blame them. And secondly, we're seeing a pattern of wetlands cropping up where people otherwise might have put roads. And so at least initially, prior to looking at this more, it looks as though you've handled two objections fairly well. You've avoided the road, and you've avoided having all the neighbors on your neck. And so I guess we'll be interested to see whether it looks as good in real life.
Are there any other comments?
My name is Edward Ryan, and I'm the developer. I'd like to comment in response to a couple of the board members' comments. The traffic impact analysis will be closely looked at, not only because I live on Mitchell Road, but because, having lived on Mitchell Road, I am very aware of the increase in traffic in the last 10 years on the road. And I'll be looking very closely at what the added 16 to 18 houses and its consequent vehicle trips will be doing, particularly as they come out to a very sharp curve on Mitchell Road where Chevres intersects it. The background information that I have on that matter indicates that accidents that have occurred in that curve are single car accidents, and they're not as a result of cars entering Mitchell Road from Chevres Road. They happen to be single car accidents involving cars traveling along Mitchell Road on an inherently dangerous curve. This second proposal is in direct response to a few things. One, board concerns. The original plan called for a single access point coming in from Spurwink Ave with the possibility of fire or emergency accesses off of it. The board didn't seem too comfortable with that. A second proposal even called for a cut-through full road over land owned by the applicant. The board didn't feel too comfortable with that, and in response to neighbors particularly did not feel comfortable with any sort of a cut-through road. And this single access from here is in response to wetlands, board concerns about cut-through roads and emergency access roads, and neighbors' concerns about cut-through roads. It's also a reaction to neighbors on the Macaulay Road side. By this configuration allows the road to be tucked over to your left a little bit, which allows for quite an extensive buffer to be placed along here. It indicates 40 feet. It could even be deeper than that, which will effectively 100% shield this development from all existing neighborhoods. With a town-owned lot here, extensive vegetation buffer there, heavily wooded here, and total isolation from neighbors in the other areas. It's one that I like a lot, and I think that we got some favorable neighbor response to that. The septic system is 100% redundant, and if the engineer requires two full systems in place, they'll of course be done. Along with your close scrutiny and his of a septic system, common septic system, I will be submitting data regarding the sewer situation and will be looking for your voluntary opinion to the town council when it is again petitioned to sewer this project. You may not respond to an applicant's request for that, but I feel that the council may request it of you at some point anyway.
Are you saying that if it were sewered, it would still be the same configuration?
Yes.
Okay.
Early on in our deliberations, you made us aware of some conversations you had with the town on affordable housing, and it indicated they had gone nowhere. Has that situation changed in any way?
The town is, the only response I've had to my proposal is the two comments made by you, one tonight and one last month, when you said the words affordable housing. And if that's the town response, it's the town response. But other than that, nothing.
Okay.
The response by neighbors on either side use those words, magic words, in this town, affordable housing, in a not a desirable way, I might add.
Any other questions on this? This is a preliminary plan review, so now's
pre-app.
Now it's time for questions on what the developer's proposing.
I have a question. On the three open space areas,
yes,
you are intending to convey those to the Land Trust?
Land Trust or the Town Conservation Commission, similar organization. Last week, before the town council, the president of the land trust, Nat Clifford, made a point that oftentimes folks like who are considering contributing land like to deal with the land trust. It can be done privately and quietly, and I've done that before, and I'd probably look forward to doing something like that again.
Mr. Chairman?
No.
There is a wooded town parcel that this planning board requested of a previous developer and achieved as a stand of woods that was a unique stand of woods. And we know how Mr. Drinan likes to screen new residential developments from existing residential properties. It will be interesting to see this road's relationship both to the wooded town parcel and to the existing residences along Macaulay Drive and Chevers Road, and as well along the existing development, Project Columbus Road and off to the south of the project. And I guess we won't see that until we get out there into a sidewalk and actually get a feel for land. I don't know that I've ever walked on this piece of land or can picture its relationship. I do have a question, though, about the location map, and it's a minor point, but it appears that the location map is coming into a different subdivision than Chevers Road, and Mr. Drinan might want to take a look at that and see if it is properly configured or if it is different. So that's a comment. The question also is whether or not any additional land is owned by Mr. Drinan in this area, or if this is the extent of the ownership that he has.
Is that a question?
Yes, it is.
The one of the earlier drawings, which I demonstrated to you, and it showed it was a neighborhood drawing. It indicated a parcel of land which comes down, if I can use the words like this without being further descriptive, and hooks back into Leiden Road or hooks around here. Do you recall that?
Yeah.
I own all of this land outright except for the road parcel here on which I have an option. This parcel over here, I think that's what you're referring to. We're talking about Mr. Hinsman. I do own it. I own it outright. There are no conditions or restrictions on that land. I do have a non-deeded agreement with the former owner that should I not use this to build a road on, I will return it. So if when this development is over, and I have not had a need to use that land, I will. It does not fall under my control at that point. So I think I, to fairly answer your question, I don't own any other land than what you see depicted here.
Does the prior owner with the reverter own adjacent land?
The reverter?
Yeah. That's what it's called.
That's the prior owner?
Well, whoever the...
Is that the prior owner?
Well, if you have a thing that you don't use it and it reverts to the prior owner,
okay,
then I'd call it a reverter.
Yeah, the prior owner, as far as I'm aware of, continues to own a large tract of land out there.
Okay. Who wants this little chunk in here?
Where is that?
Between parcel C and parcel B.
This is under some private ownership of a couple... By the way, the town owns a chunk of land in the corner right here and right here. Little triangles owned by the town of Cape Elizabeth. There's a series of paper streets that run through here, and our determination and private opinion is that this is non-developable land because of this wetland that goes through here. We think it will always remain as is. The town, by the way, does own a couple of small chunks in these corners. The ordinance will require full identification of all of this land.
Yes,
I guess.
Know. I just don't.
I don't know myself.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I think at the last session there was a question on where the end of Columbus Road is in relationship to lots 5 and 6, and is that part of the previous Canterbury lot?
Columbus Road ends here, and I know that that information was submitted at one point on a neighborhood map of this area. Where my pen is right here. Can you see that over there? Mm-hmm. This is the end of Columbus Road. It comes pretty much right down this line here, and it ends right there. And it ends at an area which picks up on that nature and conservation land of Canterbury.
Mr. Chairman, I thought since dead-end roads are an issue, have been an issue, will continue to be an issue tonight, I thought I'd just give the board the site so you can read it, and perhaps I could even read it quickly, because it's there and it's pretty clear. The board has the ability to waive things, but it's subsection 16-2-3-2A9. And it reads as follows, I'll be quick. Dead-end streets shall be no longer than 500 feet and shall not service more than 12 dwelling units unless, in the opinion of the planning board, a greater length is necessitated by topographical or other local conditions, and that the greater length will not impair traffic safety or emergency vehicle access. In no instance shall a dead-end street exceed 1,000 feet in length and service more than 20 dwelling units. So that's the current standard in your subdivision ordinance, unless you decided to waive it.
Can we really waive it if it says in no instance more than 1,000 feet if that's an ordinance of the town?
That's unclear. We'd have to check.
Might want to, Mr. Chairman, because it's now two subdivisions.
No, I took a liberal interpretation of that to mean that those two things together, more than 20 houses and more than 1,000 feet. If either one of them existed, you could waive it.
So if it was less than 20 houses.
And more than 1,000 feet is okay. Of course, that's my interpretation.
Well, I think we should probably get a reading from our town attorney on that issue. Are there any other questions? Well, I thank you for this review. I think you should be aware of the timing for submissions for our next meeting.
It's impossible for us to meet that with a preliminary plan. We intend to be back, perhaps as observers at that meeting, now to watch the public hearing that will occur. Mm-hmm. And we do intend to be back at your January meeting.
January. Okay.
And we do intend to come in with a plan substantially like this.
Like the one you're pointing at right now?
Yes.
So plan B.
Yes, sir.
With that as a provision, too, and before the January meeting, Mr. Chairman, maybe we can have some of the past research put together, as it's been done a couple of times on 1,000 feet.
Yep.
And an opinion whether the board can authorize more than 1,000 feet in length for a cul-de-sac.
Whether we can waive that.
Whether we can waive that.
Yeah. That would be an issue for Tom.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just a few minutes late, Mr. Peter Rummery, public access waiver for two lots. Good evening, Mr. Rummery.
Good evening, Madam Chairwoman and board members. I'm back again, this time with hopefully all the T's crossed and the I's dotted. Hopefully you have before you my amended application, which I believe now fully complies with the requirements of the public access waiver.
Well, Mr. Rummery, have you been made aware of a letter from the town engineer, Robert Hunter, dated November 15th? And Mr. Hunter states that the concerns expressed in his October 6th letter regarding potential encroachment of side slopes and drainage into adverse property have not been addressed and are valid as presented in the prior letter.
Yes, I was made aware of those this afternoon in a telephone conversation with Stephen Butler.
Good.
And in my discussion with him, I do believe that there is no problem that I cannot quite easily handle with Mr. Hunter. pardon me, in that the flowage would be in line with the public access way and away from Spurwink Avenue, and very easily led further onto the property, which is a way that it naturally does flow now.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly would have none of that runoff to encroach upon the abutters, and
right.
it's my opinion that it will be very easily handled that way.
Mm-hmm. Just one more question, then I want to give other people a chance. Do you have another way of accessing these lots? I see something adjacent to lot 12 on your plan.
These lots are part of a subdivision that the remaining lots of which I purchased 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that subdivision had three accesses to Spurwink Avenue, one of which is the one that I am intending to utilize as a public access way, mm-hmm. and the second is the one that I believe you're noticing coming along beside lots 10, 11, and 12. The third one appears on the, it's further north by approximately 200 feet or two lots. That's the one that I live on.
Mm-hmm. That's lot 12.
I beg your pardon?
Is that lot 12?
No.
No?
No. The one that you indicate along beside to the north side of lots 10, 11, and 12
right.
is what is the middle access from this subdivision. There is another access to Spurwink Avenue further to the north.
Uh-huh. That you are not showing on this plan.
On this particular plot. I have submitted, however, the plot plan as it appears
in the
Cumberland County Registry, which shows the entire subdivision of 1955, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I was out there on the sidewalk, and I had some of the same gut reactions, not being an engineer, as Bob Hunter expresses in his letter, and that is that you're awful close to the sidelines of the property, and you are going to be built up quite high, and the drainage has to go someplace that I don't quite understand, because I don't understand where some of these things go and how it's designed. I don't think we can just leave it that you can address Mr. Hunter's concerns about potential encroachment of side slope and drainage. I mean, you can do it, but I'm not sure that we can go much farther. At least I can't go much farther until I know how you're going to address it. And if I'm missing something, let me know. I guess I'm not sure whether you think that it's sort of a satisfactory response just to say I've seen that and I can address those, or whether you propose to give us something more.
I certainly don't expect that to satisfy you at this point. My thought was that I believe that I have substantially satisfied the particulars of the public access way, and the satisfaction of Mr. Hunter could be handled on situation of this being a contingency. I know that Bob Hunter is going to want to see an answer to his question on how that swale, if you will be indicated. The abutters' properties are both above the portion of that accessway that is being filled. You'll notice the profile that I generated is a profile of the roadway as it travels into the property. And you're correct that there would be some side slope, but the piece of land that this accessway travels over is now 40 feet wide, and to allow for a 22-foot wide pavement, you have sufficient land beside it to address this flow or side of the road situation. Now, I'm telling you that, and I reiterate, I will have to satisfy the town engineer, and I feel very comfortable that's possible, being an engineer myself.
I hope you can, because if you can, that's a major objection out of the way. I'm uncomfortable with a condition that says it's granted if the town engineer is satisfied that there won't be encroachment. It just seems to me that for this process to work the right way, we've got to see what you propose to do, and we have to see his comments on them and then make our decision. Because I think we lose more control than we're intended to lose if we leave it up to them to negotiate the major issue.
In addition, Mr. Boxer, we have had a letter from an abutter who would like to be given an opportunity to speak at a public hearing concerning this. And if you could have all of your materials ready by December 1st, which is the cutoff date, you know, we could schedule a public hearing for the next time.
This is a public hearing to
regarding
what point?
This regarding what you have proposed.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
Could I ask Steve Butler, in his drafting of the suggested motion, addressing the issues that have come up by the town engineer, whether those as appropriate conditions satisfy the concerns of board members and or the town engineer? Do they appropriately address the issues?
They address the issues. I think what Mr. Boxer does is raise the philosophical point regarding whether or not approval should be given conditionally and let the staff kind of deal with technical issues, or if this is something more that you want the staff to do ahead of time, have the applicant do ahead of time, staff review, and you have the final decision. I feel that if you didn't have a philosophical problem, that hopefully, I mean, the intent is that this suggested motion would do it, but it doesn't get to the underlying question that Dan raised.
I think it's a little bit more than philosophical. We've got one comment from a person who could be very seriously affected by this, and it seems to me we're I think, going to be somewhat derelict in our duty if we say we'll leave it up to the town engineer. Mm-hmm. So I agree with you, Steve, that you probably could handle it by a condition, but I'm not excited about doing that in a situation we have an express concern from a neighbor.
I think
you, Dan.
What,
yes,
Dan, yeah, Madam Chairman, what Dan is raising is a question I think is really gets to the heart of what we look to staff for. I think we look to staff to give us advice on applications, not to give us not to have their opinion be what stands with the application. So we're looking for their advice. I think we should take that into consideration, but I agree with Dan. We should be making our own minds up on these issues.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yes, Judith.
I would add, along with Mr. Boxer, I have remembering the sidewalk and the proximity of the properties and the homes, particularly the homes, how close they were. They're not large lots. I just feel I'd really want to have all the reports here and in hand, and have the public hearing before any kind of approval is granted.
Thank you.
An alternative to a public hearing, if we don't want to have a formal public hearing, and I don't think there's anything wrong with this, is to simply allow those people to talk the same night. I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
We are not required to have a public hearing for a public access waiver, but I think that in this instance where neighbors are likely to be impacted either by drainage or wetlands, lack of wetlands control, that it's very important to hear from them. I agree with both Mr. Boxer.
Thank you. Anything else?
Madam Chairman, if I may continue on this line.
Sure.
I certainly would like to have if there need to be a public hearing, I would like to have it as soon as possible, and if it's possible to have such a thing included with the December board meeting, I certainly would be in favor of that.
Sure.
Anything to cut down the
December
time.
1st, if you could, address the letter from the town engineer, we could set a public hearing for December 19th if you are going to appear at that time, as long as your information is in by December 1st, then you can appear on the agenda. I think we can do that simultaneously, can't we? And notify all abutters that there will be a public hearing. We are also having another public hearing, which will probably be quite lengthy that evening, so I just want to warn you.
Thank you, ma'am. Also, do I understand that the questions of the town engineer are the most pertinent to the and this public hearing are the most pertinent to my desiring the public access, in other words, it being cleared by you?
I beg your pardon?
Is this the major and hopefully the sole holdup that you perceive as a board to the application of an access waiver?
I can't answer that, Mr. Remery. I don't know what facts could be brought up by the public at the public hearing. That's why we have public hearings. And I mean, facts could be presented to us that would have to be investigated. So I can't say that this is the sole thing.
Okay.
Anything else?
Madam Chairman,
yes.
Does Mr. Remery have the Mrs. Schnell letter? Was that supplied to him so that he can address those issues as well?
I don't know, but do you have an extra copy that you could give Mr. Remery? Steve Butler, our planner, will give you a copy, and you'll know what their concerns are. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Madam Chairman, do you also want to set this for public hearing at the December 19th meeting?
Yes, I think, Mr. Remery would like that, and, it's going to be a long public hearing.
Previous to that?
Yeah.
Madam Chairman, I would move that we set this application for public access waiver for a public hearing on December 19th.
Second.
Very good. Any discussion?
Is there any need on this kind of action to be sure that the application is complete before we do that?
No, I don't think according to the ordinance we do.
I think you could have the public hearing close it, and if more information was needed, you could still ask for more information from that point forward.
Okay, hearing no more discussion on this, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, I guess we'll see you on December 19th.
Thank you,
Mr. Rumry. Next on the agenda, does anyone want to take a break on the planning board? Okay. The planning board will take a short break. We'll be right back.
Scott Balfour was finding in his business, as all businesses grow and change, with the advent of new equipment and more marketing tools, more storage requirements, he was simply running out of space. A modern office occupying the under 1,000 square feet of existing space is pretty meager indeed. And through this addition, he will be able to acquire a place for employees to hang their coats and not share them with marketing tools, pamphlets and brochures and the like. We tried very hard to blend this into the neighborhood because it is a prominent site as you come onto the Cape, really. This is kind of the signature corner of your town. And we tried very hard to blend it into the neighborhood, and I think you'll be able to see through the drawings that you have that the scale of this is quite small. What I thought would be best, and I will leave this up to you, Madam Chairman, is to go down through your code and address each of the items in the code, if you would find that the most beneficial.
To which code are you referring to,
To take a look at your site plan review, that's section 19, 2-9, and just walk down through the various components of this project, sure. If that would be helpful for you.
Sure.
And I thought I would start with required information. We have provided, and I'm going to start with 2.A and 2.B. I'll take those right off quickly. We have provided a key plans not only of the entire town and where the property is located, but there is a site plan showing and pointing out all of the existing conditions. The name and address of the owner is indicated of all of the adjoining properties, as well as trees and other landmarks and features that are important to you folks in making your determination. The proposed item D, or the lot line dimensions, I'm sorry, item C, the lot line dimensions are indicated on the larger scale plan, which is represented by the proposed site plan here, just to help me walk you through this. So that's item 2D, item, or 2C. Item 2D, I believe, indicates, you will see on this plan, all of the structures that are within the required 100 feet. The proposed location on item E, which proposed location and dimensions of the buildings, structures, roadways, and driveways, is shown on the larger scale drawing. And the existing building is shown, the white is existing, the widely spaced cross-hatched area is for both first floor and the second floor expansion of the project, and the closely spaced hash lines are the stairway at the rear. I think it's important to note that it is in the U-shaped recess towards the rear of the property is where that is located. The building setbacks are also shown on that, and then we went through the zoning board and received their approval for the variances that were required for the property. Again, item G goes, 2G goes back to the smaller scale, and that's all the trees and all of the good things, any woodlands, and all trees above 4.5 inches. Okay, item 2H, the site is flat, so we have no changes proposed in the there. Parking are indicated on the proposed site plan, and the required spaces so numbered. Okay, item, and there are essentially no changes there on the site. Item 2J, which is the improvement such as roads, curbs, and bumpers, sidewalks, there's essentially, we are proposing no changes to what is existing. Sidewalks that are there will remain. The curb cuts that are there will also remain. Item 2J, which I just went over, there's no change there. Item 2K, location and design of existing and proposed stormwater systems. There's no change from the existing. Also, all of the city utilities are in place, or town utilities are in place. Garbage is currently stored in a rear of the property shed and is removed on a weekly basis by a private carrier. Item 2L, landscaping and buffering plan showing what will remain and what will be planted. Essentially, we have shown an addition of some planting directly around the building. We've indicated some planting in a grass strip, which is in agreement with the neighbors. And I will specifically address the design and issues of buffering under item 3. Let me get to that. Okay. And if there's any question on the plant materials, we can talk about that later. The existing lighting, this is item M, which is details with the lighting and the location. We're essentially going to leave the existing lighting, which is your street town lighting that is already in place, and that's shown on the existing plan. And also on our drawing A1.1, there is some lighting on the front elevation, and there will be a entry.